Hello, I'm Alex Davies, founder of Wealth Club, and today I'm with Richard Power of Octopus Investments to talk about the Octopus AIM Inheritance Tax Service. Richard, tell me about Octopus and also tell me about your own experience.
Morning, Alex. Yes, Octopus was established just over 20 years ago and has developed as itself into the market leader in the provision of venture capital trusts and business property relief products as well. We have four core areas of focus, including real estate, renewable energy, ventures, and small quoted companies, which I'm going to talk about today. I've been at Octopus for 17 short years now. It's sort of flown by. And we now have 2.8 billion invested across the AIM market and the wider small cap market across a range of products. But a key area of focus for us is the business property relief portfolios that we're talking about today.
So Richard, tell me about the AIM Inheritance Tax Service. What's its objective?
Well, the investment objective is to provide a growth portfolio for investors, which also has the additional benefit of business of qualifying for business property relief, which means that the assets fall out of their estate after 2 years of ownership. But the real focus is on investing in good quality growing companies and taking that long-term investment time horizon and hopefully deliver strong returns for investors as well.
So good growing companies, what are the other characteristics you're looking for?
Well, the key characteristics that we look for are businesses that are going to be increasingly relevant in the world. So we take that long-term time horizon, so typically 5+ years. We're looking for companies that are profitable, they're established. We want companies with a proven management team. And what we want to do is understand the journey they need to go on in order to double their profits over a sensible time horizon. The other characteristics that we look for this specific mandate are certain qualities such as high levels of recurring revenue. We like companies with big order books going out many years. That makes their growth profile more visible, more predictable as well. And the other quality we like is businesses that have a niche or proprietary product or service. We like companies that can be global leaders in what they do. Going back to that point about these companies becoming increasingly relevant in the world.
And are there companies, sectors that you avoid?
The legislation, the tax legislation, means that we can't invest into property companies, investment companies, sectors such as oil and gas and mining. Exploration assets are deemed to be property assets, so we won't be in those sectors. Otherwise, we'd like a breadth of sector exposure. I think that's important when managing the client's risk as well. So apart from those exclusions I mentioned, there'll be a cross-section of sector exposure.
And can you talk to me about some recent investments?
We've made a number of new investments last year into companies that we'd known for a long time, but we put them into the inheritance tax portfolios for the first time. They'd include Learning Technology Group. It's a business that had actually been in our venture capital trust for about 8 years, so a business we knew well, and obviously watched its development very, very closely over those years. And it's got to a stage today where it's operating globally. Profits are expected to grow to about 60 million next year, and more importantly, its recurring revenue base is up to about 80%, so it's got that consistency and reliability of performance going forward as well. What they do, as the name suggests, is provide a digital learning platform for corporates, and obviously employee and staff training is much higher up the agenda than perhaps it was a number of years ago.
And examples of investments that you've had in the portfolio for some time?
Yes, we've got a number in there that have been in there over 10 years. Going back to my point, we want to become long-term co-owners of these companies. So there's a good 7 or 8 that have been in there over a decade. Companies like RWS Group, which is a patent translation business and localisation specialist as well. They had profits of about £8 million when we first invested in 2005. Fast forward 16 years and profits are expected to be 118 million this year and then 148 million next year once the benefits of a more recent acquisition come through as well. So you can see the substantial progress these businesses can make over that time horizon.
And how's the pandemic been for you and your investments?
A roller coaster, I think, for everybody, and particularly the companies themselves. When the pandemic first broke, management teams were very honest and open with us. They really didn't understand to what extent the pandemic might impact their business and their ability to successfully hit their profit forecasts. What we subsequently learned, and they subsequently learned, was that their companies are significantly more resilient than they expected, and a lot of most companies have come through it incredibly well, with many who expected to be impacted actually exceeding their original profit forecast for the year. So it's actually turned out to be an incredibly successful year for AIM as a result of that. So it felt a little bit hairier 12 months ago or so, but as the year progressed, our confidence increased.
And has anything done particularly badly, particularly well?
We've had sectors that have been right in the teeth of the pandemic. Obviously, leisure, retail, those sorts of sectors have been impacted more than others. The benefit of having a public listing is these companies had access to capital. They had long-term supportive shareholder to bridge that gap, and they've come through this. And actually, early trading results for most of these sectors have been incredibly strong. So we're very confident that these businesses will be hitting peak profitability again very soon.
And have you done anything to adapt your own portfolio and how you look at things?
We haven't sold any of our positions out of the portfolio as a result of the pandemic. Those businesses that had been impacted, we got a clear understanding of the level of headroom they had in order to survive and get through the pandemic, and had confidence, as I say, that they'll return to peak levels of profitability again in due course. We've had to say goodbye to a few of our investments for other reasons. Abcam, for example, dual listed on NASDAQ, which is a recognized investment exchange, so no longer qualified for BPR. And we've had a number of bid approaches for companies over the last 12 months as well. Companies like IMI Mobile, Apple Green, Scapa Group were bid for, hence the sort of new entrance into the portfolio.
So you haven't sold any stocks recently, but when do you decide it's time to sell a stock?
Well, we'll sell a stock if we feel that the investment case or the risk return for our investors is not what we thought it was. Otherwise, we want to hold companies for that longer term. That's how we believe you create the true underlying value for shareholders. So if there's a short-term headwind, it's often not the right thing to do to sell out of that stock when sentiment's already been knocked. But to sort of hold it and for the longer term and to wait and see the profits come through in due course. And so the pandemic did provide a headwind for a number of businesses, but we could see through that. In fact, we put a number of companies back on our buy list because of that headwind and where the valuation had got to as well, like Young & Co Brewery is a good example, which we had been buying many years ago. When the shares hit a low in the summer, we saw that as a great opportunity for longer term investors.
2020-21 turned actually to be an amazing year for AIM. It's now still a good time to invest.
Yes, AIM's had a tremendous 18 months. It's obviously outperformed the FTSE All Share over that period. Part of that is the constituents of the index. AIM has a much higher exposure to more progressive sectors, such as technology, medtech, or so, and nearer 12% on AIM rather than less than 1% in the FTSE All Share. And that's what's driven a lot of the outperformance. AIM is in great health at the moment. We're seeing a very, very strong list of IPO activity at the moment. And all of these, I hope, will be potential candidates for our inheritance tax service in due course. So, no, we're very excited about the future prospects for the index still.
And people always talk about AIM being really risky. How risky is it?
AIM is classified as high risk, as indeed all smaller investing in smaller companies is deemed high risk for the obvious reasons that they can be more volatile and they can be less liquid than very large companies in the FTSE 100. We work very hard to mitigate those risks through our stock selection and by investing in those businesses that are a bit more established, are profitable, businesses that have the qualities I spoke about earlier around visibility of earnings. And as a result, our portfolios do have a much lower level of volatility and the liquidity is strong across the portfolio than the wider indices themselves. It's also important to remember that this is a long-term investment and investors should be taking that 3 to 5 year time horizon and expect a degree of volatility on that journey as well.
And finally, just to give a quick succinct summary, why should someone who's looking to invest in an AIM ISA or an AIM portfolio, why should they choose Octopus?
Well, investors should always invest in who they feel comfortable with. I guess what we offer that's a little bit different is the scale of the team and the longevity that we've been doing this. We're the market leader in this market. We've got a team of 8 investment professionals focused on these portfolios. And the average tenure at Octopus of those 8 is over 11 years now. So the team's been together for a long time and got a lot of experience of companies at this end of the market.
Richard Power of Octopus Investments, thank you very much.
Thank you.